Well, hello and welcome to my video all about ports and why they're so important. Couldn't help myself, had to get that one out there. Anyways, ports really are very important because they direct traffic on the internet or on a network, whether it's a local network or whether it's across the wild world of the World Wide Web. Ports are, you can almost think of them like those pneumatic tubes. When you think of in the post office, how the post office is constantly directing mail in certain tubes to go to certain places, you could think of it like that. And those tubes are carrying data communications, and those tubes are defined by certain ports, and that defines what type of communication is happening along those tubes. Like, for example, there could be a tube that is, designated as port 80, and that could be HTTP traffic, like hypertext transfer protocol traffic, in other words, website traffic. Like, when you go to access a web page and you type in the URL, the HTTP, the hypertext transport protocol, using port 80 is what is that. It's almost like that pneumatic tube that's transporting that specific data traffic to wherever you're needing it to go, whatever server is needing to load that web page. And something to also note is usually when you think of those tubes that are making data travel, they're usually clear. And in the world of computer science, that's considered an unsecure port. So if somebody could intercept that message and see what's actually being sent through that tube via that port, they actually call them port sniffers. If someone can see what that data is, then that's not secure because someone can intercept your data. And if it's proprietary or private information, you don't want them seeing that. So, like in the case of HTTP, you have HTTPS, which is what everyone uses now. So when you see that lock symbol, and you type in HTTPS, that's Hypertext Transfer Protocol Secure, which is implying that instead of taking a clear tube that someone could see into, like hypothetically speaking, or for the sake of example, picture it as almost like a black tube or a tube that's completely obfuscated to where somebody can't see the message that's traveling through it. It's secure, and that form of security is usually encrypted. So it's still HTTP traffic, but it's encrypted HTTP traffic. So if someone does intercept it, they can't read it. They have ports for just about everything you can think of. And there's a port authority, the IANA, which stands for Internet Assigned Numbers Authority. Yes, that's actually a thing. They're the ones that assign the ranges of port numbers. And I think it's all the way through like 65,000. I have that part written down, so bear with me with my little notes. So yeah, so ports 0 through 1023 are considered the well-known or assigned ports. So those are ports that the IANA, the Internet Assigned Numbers Authority, designates what ports are going to be for what traffic. And then beyond that, ports 1024 through 49,151, that's a lot of ports. Those port numbers are considered like registered or reserved ports. So those are probably the ports that, different organizations, businesses, government most likely as well, gets assigned blocks within those port ranges so they can use them within their own networks to direct where traffic is going. You can, and outside of pneumatic tubes, like for another association, you can almost think of it like traffic control or air traffic control, like helping planes or cars or whatever know what traffic path to take. And it designates what type of communications happening on that path. But anyways, back to the number blocks. So again, 1024 to 49,151 are reserve registered ports. And then ports 49,152 through 65,535 are your dynamically assigned ports. So those are the ports that when your computer, your whatever home device you're using, is sending a message out on a certain port to a certain server, whether it's for mail, whether it's for web traffic, whether it's for telnet or whatever you might be using, then a lot of times that server will dynamically assign you one of the ports in this range number. It'll assign your device one of a port in this range number, so it knows where to direct traffic back to. Those are like your source ports. Some people call them ephemeral ports. So that's a way to think of those. Another little section of this video that I think is good to cover for those of you who might be like me studying for exams regarding this networking information is that it's more officially defined. Ports are more officially defined as, quote, unique ID numbers used by TCP and UDP, so that's Transport Control Protocol and User Datagram Protocol, for communicating data segments. And it just identifies what process or network service is being used. Like that unique port ID is identifying what process or network service is being used. And another thing that's good for more like exam related information is that it's happening on the same level as TCP and UDP. So when you think of ports and port assignments, like getting assigned port numbers, think of it in conjunction with TCP and UDP, because all of those things are happening on layer 4 of the TCP/IP model as well as the OSI model. And the cool part about that is the fact that layer 4 of the TCP/IP and the OSI model, layer 4 on both of those are called the transport layer. So transport, you have the word port in it, like the name in and of itself gives you a clue, like if you're asked a question about it, what layer you're working at and what's actually happening at that layer, and the fact that it has to do with ports. So I think that's awesome. But now for something that is way more interesting than just having to know the details for exams is the history of it. Like whenever I'm learning anything, I love to get a nice glimpse into, okay, where did this come from in the first place? Like what were some of the first people dealing with ports thinking of, and what was the context for it? So it basically started back in the ARPANET days. So earliest days of the internet, back when the internet was again called the ARPANET, and it was mainly being used by military, like the US military, as well as different universities and research institutions. And that was their method for communicating over a network. They used ARPANET. Again, this is late 60s, early 70s. And one of the earlier pioneers of all this, his name was John Postel, and he submitted a request for comments, one of the earlier RFCs that happened, for socket numbers. So back then they weren't called ports yet, they were referred to as sockets, but he was the one that thought, hey, we need to organize this a little better, make like a, you know, metaphorical pneumatic tube system to know what type of traffic over our network is going to be traveling along what method. And people back then, especially the early computer scientists, were kind of quirky. So I actually wrote down what he said. He's like, I propose that there be a czar, me, question mark, who hands out official socket numbers for use by standard protocols. And again, this is in 1972. So this concept has been around and grown quite a bit over the years. And he goes on to suggest like what the socket numbers and socket ranges are. But remember earlier I said what the INA has designated those socket ranges and socket numbers to be. And then he also, in that same RFC back in 1972, gives the first official proposals for sockets. So for sockets 1, 3, 5, 7, and 9, he recommended that socket 1 be for Telnet. He proposed that socket 3 be for file transfer, or like what we would consider FTP now. Socket 5 is for remote job entry. Socket 7 for Echo, which I'm guessing is like a modern day version of, or like a former version of what we now consider ping. And then socket 9 for discard. So probably for discarding packets. So that's, yeah, a little bit about like where ports come from, their earlier days. And then the last, but certainly not least, little note card that I wanted to make about this is what command you use. Because as I'm sure you know, in computer science and especially networking, there's usually a command associated with whatever we're doing to be able to, on a practical level, interact with these ports and know on your system what ports are open, what ports are closed, how they might be communicating. And that is the netstat command. So if you open up your command line and you type in netstat tack N or netstat tack A, then that's going to give you what current port connections are happening. And then netstat tack A shows you all of the active ports. So yeah, that is ports. I hope it was helpful for you. It's definitely helpful for me in studying, especially that history part, because it gets kind of dry when you're studying for certification exams if you don't have some like story and some context and some history. So I hope that helped too. And yeah, good luck knowing your ports.